Alright, welcome to another video. I found out that I've gotten into areas of clarity that can only be related and explained in relationship to practicing. If one practices, then one can say, oh yeah, I can see how I got here, because the practices enable me to gain a familiarity, and that's how I'm able to easily see this. Whereas if you don't, then it's just too difficult to explain. So, well, how did you figure that out? It's not the figuring out doesn't do it. It's the familiarity that does it. So in this world, what we really need is a culture of practice. That's the most important aspect of any culture of practice. It's not the big shot gurus that are so important, actually. They have their place. But practice is more important. Culture of practice. The big shot gurus should be the ones that support that. What is missing in this world is that culture of practice. That's what's missing. Can't really find it. It's very difficult to find, and especially on YouTube. So the idea of going to a teacher, big shot guru, well, you know, if one has done the practice, all the practices, really intense and is tremendously prepared, maybe that will provide a reassurance, and it gets them past what they need to get past. That's possible. But the idea of just going to a big shot teacher, guru, and seeing what needs to be seen, through a contact high or just being in their presence or something, it's quite let's just say that it's not something that necessarily can be counted upon, whereas practice, I find, it really can be counted upon. It's like the safe way, the sure way. Everybody is lazy, so they say, oh, if I just found the right teacher, everything will be fine. I know I always thought that, like, how come I can't find the right teacher? If I did, all my problems would be solved. And I never did find a teacher in the world. And the Holy Spirit always said, well, why don't you, as you're looking, why don't you just keep working as hard as you can and get as much done as possible? So, okay. And it was like that. So that kind of, you know, the idea of, oh, I just haven't found the right teacher. As soon as I find one, my problems will be solved. It's simply not true. It's not true. The turnaround that has to be made is so significant, so profound, that one has to be very deeply schooled in familiarity and expectation and valuing and the mood of repentance and everything that is needed. One has to be very much familiar with all that. The turnaround, like for instance today, that I have had is so off the charts that I don't even think I can explain it. But yet I'm comfortable with it. See, I don't need to run to a guru. I don't feel like, well, my God, you know, where's Muji? You know, but well, Muji's actually silent. He's in retreat. He's not doing anything right now, which is very interesting, because this is now the time. The next year is the time. The first blood moon of the tetrad will start in about less than 24 hours from now. This is the sign that the Bible talked about for a tetrad of blood moons with a solar eclipse in the middle of them, all falling on Jewish high holidays during this end time that we're in, which we all know we're in. So if you take everything as a whole, we realize, wow, this is when the troubles and the intensity and all of that begins. So maybe Muji's done as much as he can. Maybe he poured his heart out and did everything he could do at this time, up to this time. But we will see how things go very shortly. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know. Really don't know. Now, teachers can inspire others to practice, but what often happens is the student starts depending on the teacher, thinking the teacher's going to do it for him, which is simply not true. When Jesus left, he said, "Hey, look, it's better for you if I leave," and then you listen to the Holy Spirit. That's better for you. So he, was saying that, hey, if you just expect me to do it for you, it's not going to work. You have to see what needs to be done, as a power of decision rests within us. So we have to make the decision. It rests within us. We have to make the turnaround. We have to accept true repentance and then the holiness that comes with that. And we have to prepare for that. So this is something that you cannot just say the guru's going to do it for you, the teacher, the savior's going to do it for me. They can't decide for you. You have to decide for yourself. So he said the Holy Spirit will help you understand all this, which is true. I have found to be very true. I'm not one of these people who rely on Jesus, thinking that Jesus will do everything for me. I say, look, the Holy Spirit, I have to listen. I have to pay attention. I have to put the time and effort in and keep on practicing, keep on familiarizing with what it is I'm going to see, because the Holy Spirit knows what it has to show us. So it knows how to familiarize us with what it's going to show us. And what I was shown today is just a little too heavy to really explain effectively at this point. I'm not quite ready to carry that as far as explanation goes, because it's such an incredible realization that you just know that the vast majority of the world will absolutely disagree in the most extreme measures with what I would say. We don't understand the extent of projections, what we've done with projection. It all has to do with projection, which is a projection of our will. It's all based on that. And people are so enmeshed in projection. So enmeshed in projection. There's a little fly there. That we just don't even have a clue. We don't have a clue. We don't realize that these body minds, it's all a projection. It's all a projection. These are our children. And these children are will never, ever give us what we want, what we hope for. So I have a few practices here that are extremely profound as far as the final step, the final area. We're in the final area that needs to be taken, which is very timely, given that these are the end times, and the real action of the end times is set to get going now. So it's of great benefit that we get familiar with something that we don't realize we need to get familiar with. We don't realize it. That is for sure. I found out what's going on. It's like, wow. Our projections are not creation, are not life. They're not creations. We want them to be. But our projections will never justify our investment in them. Will never, ever justify our investment in them. Our projections will never, ever validate all the work we've put into them. Our projections will never justify all the hope that we have placed in them. We've placed so much hope in our projections. Why? We hope they will provide the evidence that we're God, that we can create separate from God, actually. See, the work and investment and hope we've put into our projections is so we can get that evidence, like, from our projections and say, hey, we don't need God. We can create on our own. We cannot. We can project on our own. We cannot create on our own. So our projections will never validate all the care we've given to them. We'll never validate it, all the care. Our projections will never justify all the concern that we have heaped upon them. All this concern. We're so concerned that they reflect back to us our creatorhood, which they never will. Our projections will never justify all the dedication that we have given them. Never justify all the dedication. Our projections will never justify all the desire that we have poured into our projections. So much desire that our projections justify and validate us as creators. They will never validate us. Our projections will never justify all the waiting that we have done. We have been waiting and waiting and waiting for our projections to validate us. And we wait in vain. We absolutely wait in vain. Our projections can't stand us. They're inherent congenital liars, deceivers. They have no respect for us whatsoever, actually. They fear us. They pretend that they're like us, kind of, or at least can tolerate us, but really they lie to us incessantly. So our projections will never justify all the patience that we have provided. All the patience. We've been so patient with our projections, right? So patient. And all of that, they'll never justify that patience. It's all down the drain. We're just waiting for and being patient. Well, it'll never happen. We're just hoping and desiring it, though. Our projections will never justify all the aspiration we have for them. We have so much aspiration for them. We want them to be perfectly happy. That we want them to recognize us and love us. They never will. Our projections will never justify all the love that we've given them. All the love. So much love we've given, trying to give to them, and they never return it. They never return the love for us. Never. We think, wow, such ingratitude. How do I change that? You can't. They're inherently ungrateful. Our projections will never validate all the plans that we have laid for them. We have so many plans that we're going to do this and this. Go. We're so into our projections, planning for them. They don't care at all. They could care less about our plans for them, and always will care less about those. Our projections will never justify all the expenditure that we have made. What an incredible expenditure, right, on our part. Looking out, watching, observing, hoping, pouring everything into those. What an expenditure, and they will never justify it or validate it. Our projections will never justify all the long suffering that we've been engaged in. All the long suffering. We've suffered so long with these projections, being rejected, humiliated, like our children just treating us with contempt. Just, you know, out of control, just feeling no guilt or shame or conscience of just lying to us nonstop, promising, lying, just awful. And we've just put up with that for so long, so we're so long suffering, it'll never be justified. Our projections will never validate the outlook that we have for them. We have such a bright, great outlook. We're just hoping that what a great outlook we have. And they'll never live up to it, never justify it. Our projections will never justify the belief that we have in them. We believe in our projections. We believe they're a creation. We believe they're a new creation. We believe they're going to be great. We believe they're going to prove that we are a prime creator. It will never happen. It will never happen. Our projections will never justify all the ambition that we have for them. So much ambition. We wanted them to succeed so badly, and they're just rank, utter, terrible failure. failures, total failures. Our projections will never justify all the promise that we have held for them. We have so much promise. We believe that they are going to validate us as prime creators. They never will. They never will. Our projections will never justify the goal that we have for them. We have this great goal, right? That they are going to be this new eternal life, this new creation that will prove that we are a prime creator. That is never going to happen. Our projections will never justify all the faith that we have in them. We have so much faith. So much faith. Yeah, they're going to do it. One day we think they're going to change and they're going to love us, you know, and everything's going to be great. The golden age, all is well. They will never, ever, ever justify the faith we have in them. They'll just keep on lying to us. Our projections will never validate this dream that we have. We have this dream that we're going to be validated as prime creator. This is a dream. We're having this dream and we just want so much to be validated. We will never be validated by our projections. Our projections will never validate the intent that we have for them. We intend for them to be the validation that we need, and they will never, ever meet that intent. Our projections will never validate the purpose that we have for them. The purpose is that they validate us as prime creator. That's the purpose, and they will never do that. And we're just so long-suffering and patient and waiting and hoping and things. You think that they'll just come around. We'll just teach them a little better. We just have to learn a little more. We got to be more loving, more patient. And what are we doing wrong as parents? You know, what are we doing wrong as prime creator? How come they don't love us? How come we're not getting? That's because they're not created. They're a projection. That's why. Our projections will never validate the function that we have gave them. All right, they will not function the way we want them to function. They'll say, "Oh yeah, we're gonna make you proud someday," and then I say, "When? Soon?" Oh, and then later they say, "Ah, no, we're gonna postpone it. It's a little later." You know, just lying to us. They'll never validate the function that we've given them. They will never validate the end that we have given them. Of how do they get to that goal? How do they get to that end? They won't. They won't get to that end. Never. Our projections will never validate the wish that we have for them. We wish them so well. We wish them well. We wish them well. Instead, they're idiots, liars, deceivers, murderers. And we wish them well, and our wishes just go on deaf ears, fall on deaf ears. Our projections will never justify all the loyalty that we've given our projections. We're so loyal, aren't we? So loyal to those. We just say, we're never going to give up. We're so loyal to them. They will never, ever justify that loyalty at all. Treat us with utter contempt. Our projections will never play out the way we want them to play out. They never will never play out the way that we want. Never. It's just, the play is always wrong. It's all botched. You say, well, wow, what happened? How come it's not playing out the way I want? It never will play out the way we want. Our projections will never, ever be true. Never, ever be true. They're projections. They're not truth. They're not creation. So projections will never be true creation. They'll always be just projections. Our projections will never, ever validate what we want them to confirm. They will never validate what we want them to confirm. They won't confirm anything for us. All they do is make us look like idiots, think like we're terrible creators. That's the only feedback we get from our projections, is that we are terrible. Our projections will never ever legitimize us. Will never ever legitimize us as prime creator. They will never legitimize us. Our projections will never authenticate us. Will never authenticate us. We'll never be authentic prime creator. our projections, we're hoping, wishing, praying that they authenticate us. They never will. They never will. There'll always be fools, idiots, liars. What does that authenticate? Does that authenticate us? No, it only makes us look bad. Our projections will never, ever prove anything. Never prove anything. We're hoping that they will prove that we're a prime creator. They will never prove anything. Our projections will never, ever vindicate us. Never vindicate us. They'll never, we're hoping they'll vindicate us because we're feeling like so terrible as prime creator, like we can't create properly. And we just feel, you know what, my children, my projections, one day you're going to vindicate me, vindicate all my loyalty, my love, my patience, my concern. You're going to vindicate me to stick with you, all this loyalty. No, they won't. No, they won't. We'll never, never going to vindicate all our time and effort and concern and love and dedication and patience and waiting and hope and investment. And expenditure and long suffering and belief never ever vindicate our sticking with them. Never. There'll always be this lying ingrates, really, with contempt, disdain for us, actually. Our projections will never ever substantiate what we want them to substantiate. They will not do it. They're useless for that, absolutely useless. Our projections will never ever deliver upon what we want them to deliver upon. They won't deliver the goods. They will not deliver the goods for us. Never will they come up with anything that we really want from them. Our projections will never let up on their ingratitude. They'll never let up on their lying. Never. Our projections will never unfold the way we want them to unfold. They'll never bloom. They'll never blossom, bloom, unfold the way we want them to. It's always wrong. It's like, why did you do that? Why are you not unfolding the way I want you to unfold? They never will. Our projections will never relent in their attitude. They're unrelenting in their attitude. They don't like us. They're afraid of us. They're rebellious towards us. They reject us. They lie to us. They use us. They abuse us. They'll never relent in any of this. They will never, our projections will never give any quarter. They'll never give any quarter to us, actually. We keep hoping that they'll change their attitude. They will never change their attitude. They'll never give quarter. Our projections will never show mercy upon us. They're not merciful. They're not merciful. And we just think that at some point they'll feel like, you know, some mercy in their heart to say, why am I been treating my creator so terribly? I want to show some mercy to that. They'll never ever show mercy to us. Our projections will never ever have pity on us. They won't take pity on us. No matter how long have we suffered hoping and praying and pouring all our care and concern and trust and loyalty into them, and yet they don't have any pity upon us. No pity upon us. Our projections will never, ever make a turnaround. Our projections will not make a turnaround. Their way is set. Why? Because they are projections and not a creation. They're not creations. They're not life. They're projections. They cannot turn around. Our projections cannot ever change. They can't change. They're always going to be the way that they are. Always. Our projections will never answer our prayers. Or my projections, you could say, my projections will never answer my prayers. My projections will never, ever answer my prayers. My prayers are that they change, make a turnaround, have pity, show mercy, give quarter, relent, spare us. No, they will not. They will never answer our prayers. My projections will never ever justify all my giving. So much giving. I've given and given and given and given and given, right? They will never justify my giving to them. So we say, My projections will never justify all the devotion that I've showed them will never, ever justify that. They'll never, ever justify all the devotion. It's all been a waste. All that devotion has been a waste. My projections will never, ever be what I want them to be. They will never be what I want them to be. Very powerful here. My projections will never be what I want them to be. My projections will never grow up. They'll never grow up. They'll never grow. They'll never mature. They'll never grow up. They'll always be the way that they are. They'll never be the way I want them to be. My projections will never develop. They'll never develop into what I want them to be. My projections will never be what I want them to be. My projections will never mature. They will never mature. My projections will never mature and be what I want them to be. My projections will never be what I want them to be. Okay. Powerful, powerful practice. See, we control the practice. It's in words, phrases, nice little sentences, practices. And so we can take little bite-sized pieces of this. And in doing so, we develop the capacity to digest this fundamental realization. And once we keep taking these little bite-sized pieces, at some point we'll have the capacity to digest the whole realization and acceptance that, yeah, projections, I have to, you know, an insight will come about projections that'll be a big one. It'll be the big one. And you just say, ah, okay, I can handle that. So this is how practice works, little bite-sized pieces to help one day, soon, usually, digest the big piece. That's the secret of practice. If you don't practice, you won't be able to digest the big insight. It won't come. It won't even arise for you because you can't choke it down. It's too much. It is. It's really too much, for sure. Because there's always a big wow factor to when you see the bigger picture. It is just wow, and it renders speechless almost. It's just like, whoa. My projection. I realize, oh my gosh. So that's what it is, you know. And then you see even more than we're saying here as far as how much projection we're doing. And wow. But you can digest it because you've practiced this. You realize getting used to my projections will never be what I want them to be. They're useless to me. Except they're useless for them to be what I want them to be. But here's the big but. And this is where the teachings of Jesus come in, actually, in A Course in Miracles, is we can give our projections a different purpose. In fact, God has given them a different purpose through the Holy Spirit. And we can give them a different purpose, which is to reflect non-projection. The vision of holy oneness blesses all projections, all space and time, which is a projection, in a way that simply reflects non-projection. And so we're reminded of reality, which has no projection at all, reminded of reality now through this blessing of holiness upon all of our projections. So we don't have to get rid of the form, shape and form, time and space of our projections. We give a different purpose. We accept this blessing upon all our projections. All time, all space. Same blessing. Same blessing upon a trillion years in the future as a trillion years in the past, as right now. Exact same blessing. same blessing right here as the same blessing a trillion light years in that direction, a trillion light years in that direction, a trillion light years in any direction from here, same blessing, absolutely the same blessing. This is the potency of holiness. This is the potency of the vision of oneness. This is what we have to get used to, get ready for. Same blessing here, same blessing everywhere. Same blessing on me, same blessing on everyone. Same blessing on this, same blessing on that. Same blessing now, same blessing always. And remember, we're being reminded of non-projection. So that's why the same blessing rests upon everything, past, present, and future, all space, everywhere. So we don't feel like it's a projection anymore, right? Because projection brings about time and space. Because when we project what we think is a separate creation, it isn't a separate creation. We immediately say that because it's a new creation, there's a new way to relate to it, which is called time and space. And that borrows us. It gives us the ability to continue to believe in it. We're just saying it takes a lot of time before it fully gels, before we fully appreciate it. It takes a lot of space to be what it is. And to put it all together. And so time and space is something that we're projecting. It's a projection that enables us to plausibly say that there's a new new creation. We create something new, but we can't yet or we could say it's taking a while to emerge. It takes a lot of time to emerge. It has to evolve. We think our new creation is something that evolves over a massive amount of time and space until it's finally, it's like that. You see, it's a process. We say it's a process. All that is projection. Process, time and space, and appearances in time and space are all projections. So to be reminded of non-projection means that the you call it a feeling of holiness or the presence of holiness is everywhere, both here, past, present, and future, and all space here and everywhere. Same, exact same holiness everywhere. And that reminds us of non-projection. See? Non-projection. And yet there's still time and space and appearances in time and space, and yet because the exact same holiness resides everywhere, including in the past and including in the future, including where you are, what you can see, including everything you can't see, sensory perception-wise, everywhere, it doesn't feel like a projection at all. No longer feels like a projection. It feels like non-projection. It reminds us of non-projection. So we don't have to get rid of things. We just have to realize that this thing, the blessing of holiness that rests upon this thing, also rests upon all things, and also rests upon all non-things. Rests upon whatever state this is in now, whatever state it will be in a trillion years, whatever state it was a trillion years before. All exact same holiness resting upon it. See, this is the potency. This is what reminds us of non-projection. This is what the spiritual path is supposed to get you ready for. Has to get you ready for this. And this is such a profound realization. One has to be ready to digest this and say, yeah. And by doing practices every day, you get very seasoned that way. And you say, okay, yeah. But how else can you really, accept that? It's unlikely that one would be able to just accept it just like that with no practice. It's very unlikely. So holy vision of oneness rests upon this place here as it is now, and this place as it was a trillion years ago, billion years ago, whatever you want to say, million years ago. The holiness rests in this place as it will be in a million years, in a billion years, right here. It rests upon this space. It also rests upon that space there and that space there, as it is throughout all time, all permutations, all changes, whether the ocean will be here in 1,000 years, 1,000,000 years, whether the planet will be here, all that doesn't matter. The holiness rests upon all of that, and exactly the same as it rests upon it right now, in the past, present, and future. No difference. No difference. Totally undifferentiated that way. So this is heavy stuff, heavy lifting, but it's the heavy lifting that gets the job done. And the exercises are not so difficult. It's just a matter of doing them. And each one, try to get the let each one evoke a reaction, a feeling like, wow. Yeah. Sort of allow it to resonate like a bell ringing. Ding, 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 ding. We were at Palm Sunday Mass today. We were outside, and outside there's this huge bell tower. And the priest finished saying what they were saying, and we raised the palm fronds. And right at that point, after just finished the whole thing, before they could start something else, suddenly the bell tower started ringing to mark the top of the hour. And it ran on and on and on and on. I think I counted the bell. It rings like 40 some odd times, 42 times, something like that. And everyone was just silent and quiet there as it just kept ringing and kept ringing and kept ringing. That's really practice. Practice is where you let the bell just let the ring dong, dong, you know, bong, bong, like that. Each practice should ring your bell like that. You just keep ringing the bell. And again, once it finally stopped, then the priest went on with the, you know, with what's in the book and the, but it was interesting to realize everyone was just quiet there for a while. Exercises are like that. Is you stop the linear flow of talk, and you are just using these little, you know, reverberating, ringing the bell, as it were, over and over and over and over and over again. After a while, you get used to that bell, and then you can have the big bell get rung, then you know, bigger one, bow, really powerful, and you just go, okay, I'm used to. Being in, the, you know, hearing the reverberation, the potency, the silence when the bell gets rung, it'd be quiet. I'm used to all that, so it's not so difficult, not so difficult. It can be, you know, a little bit difficult for sure. This morning, a little difficult for sure. Wow. I realized, you know, that my projections have just been playing me for a fool, and you hate to realize that. You realize they always will play you for a fool. And you're not a good parent, because these are not a creation. These are projections. You cannot be a good parent to projections. It's impossible. Those who continue to strive to be are just being prideful. And they're, you know, they have to realize the truth at some point themselves too. Tough, tough disillusionment. You got to prepare for disillusionment. Definitely our projections are totally disillusioning. Totally disillusioning. Total disillusionment in them. But we still love them because we want them, you know, to be. So God doesn't say, those are just projections, get rid of them. No, God said, God knows we want to love these projections. So we keep the shape, the form, everything. Keep it. Just now we feel this. The holiness is blessing everything equally, past, present, future, here, everywhere. So we feel the love of God for us that way, and realize God understands. you know, love and our attempt to love a new creation, a separate creation, was still based on love, wanting to do that. But we just were whimsical about it. We thought, hey, let's see if we can create separate from God. We cannot. There's only one will. There's no separate will for us to create. We cannot create a separate will or create as a separate will. It's impossible. So keep in mind, these little bite-sized pieces are really the key. Really the key. You build up your tolerance. Build up your tolerance. So at some point it becomes easy. What you thought you could never get, you say, oh, that wasn't so bad. It's pretty easy, actually. But really, these insights, the intellect can't do anything with them. When you realize that your projections have been playing you for a fool, lying to you all along, you know, what could the intellect do to, you know, calm us down, to enable us to cope with that? What can the intellect do? No, this is, you know, really potent stuff. Potent. It hurts, you know. It really hurts. Oh. But what helps is you say, oh, yeah, vision of holiness. I can handle a vision of holiness. That's how I'm going to have to go to bless all my projections equally. And you have to feel that's possible for you. So you have to have practiced it and you feel like, oh, I think I'm familiar with that, and I think I can use that to calm me down, and that's what helps. Whereas just the intellect will just the intellect's a projection too, actually. When we're entertaining that, we're entertaining projection, trying to educate it, hoping that it will become more profound, which it doesn't. But we can use something very similar to the intellect with reason. Reason is very similar. And uses words, concepts. And that's what we've been doing here. Using reason. Our projections will never be what we want them to be. Never. So the blood moon is coming up. We've gotten to this point, able to see the answer, working to get it clear enough for us so it sticks with us no matter what turmoil comes up. We say, ah, we have the answer. We know the holy vision of oneness. The holy vision of oneness is the answer, and we can practice towards it. So this is so important to have this in place before the April 15th. That we can say, ah, okay, I know I can practice towards the goal. So I don't have to get caught up in the intellect, emotionalism, intellect of the ego, what's happening in the world. I can go right to these little bite-sized pieces and just start eating these little pieces like popcorn. It's like eating caramelized popcorn or something. It's like there's this huge, you know, gigantic bloody steak that the world is saying, you gotta eat this. Here, eat it. And we're saying, wow, I can't eat it. And we're saying, here, no. We have this wonderful, you know, chocolate bar that we need to eat, but it's so rich, we need to eat, practice. So we're eating like this chocolate-colored caramelized popcorn. Just one at a time, you know. Just one at a time, and we're getting used to this richness of it. Gradually we get used to it, so we have the popcorn, we have what we need, and so we don't have to worry about this big old bloody horrible hunk of flesh that the ego's telling us supposed to eat. This big hunk of flesh, no, we're not going to pay attention to this big hunk of flesh we're supposed to eat. We're going to just eat these nice tidbits of chocolate covered popcorn, chocolate caramelized popcorn, bit by bit by bit. And then we may just grab a chunk of chocolate and, you know, eat that. Say, wow, that was powerful chocolate, wonderful chocolate. And keep eating the popcorn. We know we can do it. We know we have the exercises, so we don't need to worry about the world at all. It's all projection. The world's a total projection. And our projections will never be what we want them to be, so why even pay attention to it? It'll never be what we want it to be. As we just went through all of these terms, it will never, you know, validate our investment, our work in it, our hope in it, our care in it, our concern, our dedication to it, our desire, our waiting, our patience for it. It will never justify all the aspirations, expectations, love, and plans, and expenditures, and outlook, and belief, and ambition, and promise, and the goals, and faith, and dream, intent, purpose, function we have for it. It'll never validate the end, the wish we have for it. Oh, it'll never justify all the loyalty. It'll never play out, be true, confirm, or legitimize, or authenticate us. It will never prove or vindicate or substantiate us at all. It'll never deliver on the promise we have for it. It'll never deliver for us. It'll never let up on us. It'll never spare us. It will never unfold the way we want it to. It will never relent or give quarter or show mercy or have pity on us whatsoever. Never. It will never make a turnaround or change. It will never answer our prayers. It will never give us anything, grant us anything. It will never justify our devotion. It will never be what we want it to be. It will never grow, develop, or mature. It will never, ever be what we want it to be. So why should we keep trying to eat that huge, horrible slab of flesh? It'll never taste the way we want it to taste. It'll never be what we want to eat, right? It will never be. No way. So, and doesn't, we don't have to do that. We can get ready for the holy vision of oneness. The holy instant, the holy vision of oneness covers all past, present, and future, all places, all space, equally. At the same moment, the same instant, just an instant. It's all that's needed. Since it's all equal, it only needs an instant, right? It only needs this instant to be what it is. It doesn't need process to be what it is, because it's covering all process equally. All past process, all present process, all future process. Already covered. Now, I believe in Judeo-Christianity, that this is what some Christians refer to as the blood, the precious blood of Jesus, covering all our sins, so to speak. All our sins means our projections. I don't know. They have some sort of deep spiritual, they can relate to it somehow. It's the way that they use that. I've never gotten what exactly they mean, but I believe this is probably what they mean. Probably, but It has to be really carefully practiced, actually. That, you know, the precious blood of Jesus, really, it is our own holiness that is blessing, that is resting upon. They say, oh, you know, washed in the blood. All our projections are washed in the blood, as it were. They're thinking about washing, like dirtiness, you know, things that we close are dirty, but precious blood of Jesus washes our clothes clean, washes our projections. It takes away the feeling of projection, is what it does. And it gives us this feeling of non-projection. That's what it really does. And it's our holiness that gives it to us. Actually, God's gift of holiness to us is the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is able to bless all time, all space, all process. This instant. All of us blessed this instant. So we must decide what we're going to eat going forward. Are we going to eat that chocolate popcorn, or, you know, chocolate nuggets or something like that? Or are we going to try to eat that bloody, massive hunk of rotting flesh that the world wants us to eat, that insists that we eat, that is chaining us all and saying, okay, dig in, this is your food. Terrible stuff, maggots in it, rotting stench, you know, the most horrifying, revolting meal possible, and the ego's telling us this is what we have to eat. No, we don't have to eat that. That's what our projections are telling us we have to eat. Our projections are feeding this to us, want us to eat on this. We say no. This is never be what I want to eat. Okay, so we'll say no, I'm going to accept the vision, the holy vision of oneness. That's my salvation from this misadventure into projection. Remember, none of these projections are real. So it's not like we're abandoning our children. They're not real. They never will have been real, never will be real. They're nothing. They're meaningless. There's no life to them. It's just a desire. That's all it is. Projected desire. And then our imagination. Our imagination. So here we go. Here we go. Here we go. With all of this. And let's see what happens with me. I don't know. I don't know. It's I'm certainly getting incredible breakthroughs every day that are just like very heavy stuff. But just have to trust in the process and stay confident, stay optimistic, and don't be worried. Don't be worried. Just say, I'm sure everything's going to be fine. I'm sure everything's going to be fine. And just keep that focus. You just use your will to keep that focus and say, you know, it's covered. We have it covered. We have the exercises. Holy Spirit is with us. And have confidence and faith in that. All right? And just make that will and just say, this is how I'm approaching the situation. You know, this is how I'm going to do it. All right? Very great. How do we do here? Even less than an hour. That's amazing. That's amazing. Okay. And we will see. Blood mood coming up. We will see what the next situation is like. Okay, that's it.